Cisco Niebuhr, Harrison Ford is stranded with Anne Heche for 6 days, 7 nights. Jessica Lange avows Elizabeth Shue in her wicked scheme as Cousin Bet. And Jennifer Love Hewitt is the object of affection in Can't Hardly Wait. Ford and Anne Heche are in for a bumpy landing on a remote island in 6 days, 7 nights, one of 5 new films we'll be reviewing this week on Siskel and Ebert. I'm Roger Ebert of the Chicago Sun-Times. My colleague Gene Siskel is right on schedule recovering from his surgery, and he's seen all the movies and once again will be joining us by telephone. Are you there, Gene?
You bet I am, Roger. I am, as always, Gene Siskel of the Chicago Tribune.
Okay, first movie, 6 days, 7 nights. Is a lightweight romantic comedy that uses that thunderstorm we just saw in the opening scene as an excuse to crash land a charter pilot and a New York magazine editor on a deserted Pacific island. He's played by Harrison Ford as a free spirit. She's played by Anne Heche as a city dweller who at first expects him to come up with a quick fix.
Aren't you one of those guys?
What guys?
Those guys, you know, those guys with skills.
Skills?
Yeah. You send them out into the wilderness with a pocket knife and a Q-tip and they build you a shopping mall. You can't do that?
No, I can't do that.
She's engaged to be married and he has an island girlfriend, but of course we know the conventions of the plot absolutely require them to
What's
be powerfully
the
attracted to one another.
Some sort of creature has just swum up my pants. I'm guessing a snake.
Oh. That's bad.
Meanwhile, back on a resort island, her fiancé, played by David Schwimmer, is getting along fine with Ford's girlfriend, played by Jacqueline Overdorf.
Listen, so how do we find them? Well, we're going to fly over the water and look out the window.
Ford has warned Heche they may be on the island a long, 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 long time. Their only hope is a single rescue flare.
What the hell did you do? What the... You wasted our only team flare?
Harrison Ford and Anne Heche have an easy comic rapport with one another, and 6 days, 7 nights is pleasant enough to watch, and sometimes it made me smile. But it's one of those movies you wait for until it turns up on video or TV. There's really nothing special or compelling enough about it that requires you to make a trip to the movie theater. It's all put together out of spare parts from other movies, and the actors don't seem very worked up by the material. Gene?
Well, I'm pretty much in agreement with you, Roger. Maybe I liked it a little bit more because I really liked both lead performances. Here's a compliment to Harrison Ford. He is, right now, probably the best light romantic comic actor we have working for us. There were a couple of moves that he made in this film that reminded me, and here is the compliment, of Cary Grant.
He has a real nice rapport in the film, but on the other hand, I felt that the material wasn't really good enough to deserve Harrison Ford playing it.
Okay, now let's deal with the big buried issue on this movie, which is Anne Heche, of course, has declared herself to be a lesbian, so people have said, gee, are we going to believe her in a romantic role with a man? And I think this is a specious issue.
Well, Gene, I didn't even bring up the fact that this whole controversy has been swirling about her, because for that matter, Harrison Ford is a married man, and yet he's pretending to be in love with this other woman. I mean, that's what actors do. They pretend
that's
to be
exactly,
somebody that they're
Roger,
not.
Roger, that is exactly the way I was going to finish my remark, which is, it's a no-brainer for any actor to pretend to be in love with someone they're not in love with. I mean, this is exactly what they do all the time in basically most every movie they make. I watched Anne Heche, by the way, an actress who I have thought and repeatedly have complimented on stealing most every movie she's in. And the reason she does is because she's so smart.
Okay, next movie. And if 6 days, 7 nights seems cobbled together out of spare parts, Can't Hardly Wait plays like a fire sale at the Reject Movie Store. This is one of those high school graduation day comedies that seems to open every June. There's one every year, but it's dead in the water. A movie with unconvincing characters and contrived situations with labored dialogue and not much of a story to pull them through. It stars Ethan Embry as a graduating senior who's had a crush on Jennifer Love Hewitt for 4 years. He feels he missed his destiny in his freshman year, and he's thrilled to learn that she has finally broken up with her boyfriend.
Where'd she go?
Right there.
He didn't see me.
Her longtime steady realizes he made a big mistake breaking up with her and tries to repair the damage too late.
I think we should get back together.
Why?
What?
If the hero had any sense, he'd forget about dating a sex bot and fall in love with his best friend. She's played by Lauren Ambrose, who, for my money, plays the only interesting character in the entire movie.
Okay, the special space for you to find in the back. Why don't you get your senior portrait taken?
We're going to avoid moments like this one, actually.
Can't Hardly Wait mostly takes place at an endless beer blast where the characters pair off for dialogue that revolves endlessly around the earth-shaking question of the popular girl's future. Meanwhile, the Lauren Ambrose character gets locked in the bathroom with a would-be cool dude, and they have the only scenes in the whole movie that have any life in them. What a waste of time. Gene?
I agree with you completely, Roger. The whole picture is you attend a party that you wouldn't want to attend in real life. These kids are doing getting drunk, doing crazy things, and every once in a while, they will utter a line with some sexual content, something a little shocking, just to sort of, keep the audience interested or awake, I guess. At one point, a character says, "I'm harnessing my chi." The whole point of including that is it's like, a catchphrase. That's it. They're not interested in writing through a full character and creating an arc of a life, but it is truly a bad quilt of a movie.
I agree with you. With the Lauren Ambrose character, she's smart and she knows really how silly and superficial her classmates are, and every time that she opens her mouth, she punctures the illusion that anyone else in the film is interesting, because she is so much more interesting. We would like to see a whole movie about people like this, for example, as we did in Say Anything, or American Graffiti, for that matter. Later in the show, Eric Stoltz and Annabella Sciorra star in Mr. Jealousy. Coming up next, Jessica Lange plays the ambitious and calculating Cousin Bet.
Oh, and I recognize you when I stumble
in the park. I love her talk as if she were my own daughter.
I don't think it's unseemly haste.
Hugh Laurie plays a man whose wife has just died, and Jessica Lange plays the wife's cousin, and all of her life she sacrificed so the more popular cousin could succeed. But now in that scene, she expects a marriage proposal after the cousin has died, and only gets a job offer as a housekeeper. That's the insult that fuels Cousin Bet, a sharp-edged and merciless social satire based on a novel by Balzac about a parish where greed is the ruling passion. Cousin Bet works as a seamstress in the theater and has made a friend of a notorious entertainer named Jenny, played by Elizabeth Shue. What Jenny doesn't know here is that the young artist she's fallen in love with is a man Bet has rescued from suicide and secretly loves herself with a hopeless intensity.
But you weren't supposed to fall in love.
Miraculous, isn't it?
Where are you going?
To the Rancho de Cangala, night of savage sex and dinner.
In her spare time, Bet cares for her younger cousin, Horton, played by Kelly MacDonald, who pesters her for hints about the man she loves.
I'd like to see him.
Turn around. Stand up straight.
He's just an awful old bank clerk with a goatee.
But the family is going broke, and Horton's is forced to listen to marriage offers from much older men, including the rich and lustful Lord Mayor of Paris, played by Bob Hoskins.
You won't marry me?
Never.
I'll give you 200,000 francs for a glimpse of your naked body.
Never.
But why?
There is not a single really good person in all of Cousin Bet. But, of course, that only makes the plot more fascinating, as the venomous and vindictive Bet cynically manipulates everyone to do her will, whether they know it or not. It's a fine, barbed, focused performance by Jessica Lange, and I like the movie. Gene?
I liked it too, Roger, and Jessica Lange's performance is the main reason why. I mean, frankly, she is the movie. And what I appreciated about her performance is she's playing, as you mentioned, a manipulator And yet she doesn't play her in some sort of sharp, angular way.
Oh, yeah, and there's a scene at the end of the film where she's holding a baby and looking at that baby, and you have a Madonna and child situation, except it's just filled with horror when you realize what she has gone through and who she has manipulated and the lives that she has changed and directed and puppet mastered in order to get that baby in her arms, the look in her eyes.
Hey, Roger, at one point, a character tells her or says about her, the devil has a sister.
Yeah.
It's a great line, and it's just fascinating to watch. The other thing, of course, is Balzac's concern, which is just to show, you know, the folly of man and woman.
You know, we've often said on the show that the villains are more interesting than the heroes in a lot of movies, and that's sure the case with Cousin Beth.
Oh, certainly. I mean, she is a marvelous character, and again, Jessica Lange is there every moment, quietly in command of this picture.
Okay, when we come back, Eric Stoltz goes undercover to learn more about his girlfriend's former lover in Mr. Jealousy.
Man, Steven, I was just thinking about you the other day. I can't remember in what context.
Who's Mikey? Some 12-year-old?
Yeah, the same guy. I've mentioned him to you, I'm sure.
That's Eric Stoltz as Mr. Jealousy, a hip, articulate, would-be writer from Brooklyn who's fallen in love with Annabella Sciorra and is now made uneasy by jealousy. Who did she date before she met him? Did she like them more than she likes him? And in particular, what about her relationship with a hot young writer? To find out more, Stoltz decides to join the writer's therapy group, but he wants to do it anonymously, so he approaches his best friend, played by Carlos Jacote.
You said you'd go if you had the time. I couldn't give my personal information because then the writer will find out about Ramona. So I said I was you. But don't worry, I'm not going to talk. It was just so Dr. Polk would let me in.
I'm a slight bit flabbergasted. So when you go to therapy next week, the group calls you...
Ben.
Meanwhile, Annabella Sciorra, who works as a guide in an art museum, is trying to deal with Stoltz, who seems to grow more distant the more he falls in love with her.
Why were you so quick to make love to me?
I liked you.
So you hop in the sack with everyone you like?
No.
A lot of the humor comes out of Stoltz pretending to be someone he isn't. He's pretending to be his friend, and that leads to some strange moments in the group when Jacote himself joins up and has to play the first guy.
And then she lied. I mean, it was early in our relationship. She says we weren't us then, but I don't know. To me, it suggests a lack of commitment up front.
Mr. Jealousy was written and directed by Noah Baumbach, who made Kicking and Screaming one of the most literate of the Generation X movies. I like the acting, and I especially like the dialogue, which is smart and doesn't feel the need to spell everything out. But I don't know about the plot. The whole business about trading identities is sometimes handled as comedy, sometimes seriously, and ends up mostly being a gimmick that gets in the way. I like Baumbach's filmmaking, but I don't think that this movie quite works. Gene?
I agree with you, Roger. This is going to be a strange comment for a movie called Mr. Jealousy. I didn't think the Eric Stoltz character was jealous enough. I mean, that's what you would expect. Frankly, if he had been played by, let's say, somebody more from our generation, let's say Steve Martin or Charles Grodin, you would expect a guy who would, you know, a classic case of where there'd be one hilarious moment after another where his jealousy got him in trouble.
Mm-hmm.
We just don't get that. It's not that funny. And I would call him Mr. Hesitant more than anything else.
Well, he's kind of a Woody Allen character or one of the characters from one of those Whit Stillman movies, a guy who feels feelings, but at the same time is always analyzing his own feelings to see whether they're the right feelings or not. He doesn't even have enough confidence in himself to feel his own emotions unapologetically.
Okay, I got a new title for the picture. Mr. Preoccupied.
Very good.
Okay.
When we come back, Ali Sheedy is a former photographer yanked out of hiding by a passionate young editor in high art. Now we come to what I think is the best movie on today's show, High Art, the story of an ambitious young woman who thinks she's found a way to score points at the magazine where she works, but discovers that life is not that easy. Rhonda Mitchell stars as an assistant editor on a high-style New York photo monthly who discovers that her upstairs neighbor is a photographer who was famous 10 years ago, but has since drifted right out of sight. The photographer is played in a performance of wonderful depth and complexity by Ali Sheedy.
There's a satin little line between me and work. And people were glomming on to something I was doing then. And I just got trapped. I mean, I loved the attention, but I just couldn't handle the impact.
One of the reasons the older photographer ended her career was because of the emotional demands of her lover, a former Fassbinder star from Germany who has now disappeared into heroin addiction. Patricia Clarkson creates a fascinating character, stone, hardly able to move, like a spider in the way she repairs her web.
I don't have a life here. I came here to be with you so that you could have a life here. I had everything in Berlin. I had a great career.
The young editor has a live-in boyfriend, but she's intrigued by the decadence in the apartment upstairs and strongly attracted sexually to the Ali Sheedy character, although eventually she's put off by Sheedy's drug use.
I didn't know you were bringing that.
The movie finds a nice balance between its romantic plot and its career plot. It knows how ambitious young people can find a way to rationalize a connection between their jobs and their desires.
Okay. I want to work with Sid on it.
Really? Sid's in the office every day. She's involved in all of our projects.
I mean, she can certainly give some feedback. We always encourage that from her. No. I want Sid to be my editor.
After the tame and predictable characters I've seen in a lot of recent movies, the power and originality of the characters in High Art came like a wake-up call. I was surprised how real I thought the characters were, how human and uncertain and convincing. The movie was written and directed by Lisa Cholodinko, who brings it empathy and close, unsentimental observation. Dean?
Well, I liked it too, Roger. I do have a complaint. In a movie called High Art, I don't feel there's enough about the art. I wanted to see more of the photographs. Eventually, late in the picture, when she does a cover, we get it. But if you're going to make her a photographer,
well, I think there's a lot about her art. For example, there are the photos that she thinks are phony and the photos that she thinks are real. And at the end, when one cover is rejected and the other one is chosen, it makes a real statement about what that woman was about.
I wanted more. I think that, again, her character is quite interesting. The relationship is mature. Complex, feels real.
It does. And Ali Sheedy does a great job here, I think, playing totally against what we used to think of as her type.
Oh, yeah. I mean, hey, listen, if you're going to compare this movie against what we've been seeing lately, of course, anything's going to come up big because we have been seeing a lot of junk,
this is
as
a
we
good
have
movie.
Pointed out week after week.
Okay, when we come back, my video pick of the week, another film in which a woman changes her entire life in the service of art.
Siskel and Ebert's video pick of the week is brought to you by Nestle Raisinets. At the movies or at home, Raisinets.
There have been a lot of ambitious women on this week's show. Anne Heche's editor, Jessica Lange's cousin Bet, Rhoda Mitchell's photo editor, and they put me in mind of Sally Potter, who got some really mean-spirited reviews for a film that I thought was entertaining and completely admirable. In The Tango Lesson, she plays a British film director who attends a tango performance in Paris and is fascinated. She seeks out the dancer, played by Pablo Varone, and asked him to become her teacher.
Do you work in the cinema?
Yes. Do you give tango lessons?
Yes.
She turns out to be a gifted student, and it's interesting that Sally Potter's own tango lessons led to this movie. Tango Lesson is really about a showdown between iron will and romantic weakness. The movie discovers that it takes the first quality to become a great dancer and the second one to destroy your work. What Sally Potter accomplishes here is remarkable, and I was really saddened by the need some people had to put her down, as if she were too ambitious because she learned to dance for this movie. It's a fine film. Now let's take another look at the movies we reviewed this week. Two Thumbs Down for 6 Days, 7 Nights with Harrison Ford and Anne Heche We both liked the performances, but didn't feel the movie was compelling enough to recommend. Two thumbs down for Can't Hardly Wait, which was a complete waste of time, except for the Lauren Ambrose character. Two thumbs up for Cousin Bette, with its strong performance by Jessica Lange as a woman determined to get what she thinks she has coming to her. Two thumbs down for Mr. Jealousy, which had good dialogue and insights, but suffered from an unnecessarily cluttered plot and not enough jealousy. And two thumbs up for High Art. I thought it was one of the year's most absorbing films, about an ambitious young career girl intrigued by a dangerous lifestyle. Gina Myers at two, but thought there should have been more in it about the photograph. Remember, you can hear our reviews on the web at Siskel-Ebert.com. Next week, we'll be back with reviews of more of their movies, including The X-Files, starring David Duchovny and Gillian Anderson in the big screen version of their hit TV series.